Now the fifth question is, friends, identify actions an enforcement authority might take if it finds that an employer is not meeting its responsibilities. So the possible actions which the enforcement authority can take, such as giving advice or warning, either it can be verbally or in writing. Similarly, requiring that an improvement is made within a given period of time. Similarly, requiring the cessation of work until improvements in health and safety are made. Cessation means to stop the work. Similarly, taking formal legal proceedings such as prosecution of the company. Now the sixth question is, explain the role of national governments and international bodies in formulating a framework for the regulation of health and safety. So what is the role of national governments and international bodies? So for this you can write, national government's role in respect of establishing laws and setting up the means for those laws to be enforced. Similarly, national government's roles such as the promotion of worker and the trade union rights and requiring good standards when the state is the client for the contracts. These two points you have to elaborate and you have to write about the role of national governments and international bodies considering these two points. Now another important question, identify the powers given to health and safety enforcement officers who are appointed under the Health and Safety at Work Act 1974. So for this you can write, this power includes the right to enter any office premises if necessary by enlisting the assistance of a police officer, to carry out examinations and investigations, to direct that premises or equipment be left undisturbed for the purpose of further investigation, to take measurements and photographs, to inspect and or to take copies of documents and records. They can use it to take samples, to require a person to answer questions and sign a declaration to the truth of his or her answers. Similarly, to take the possession of articles, to issue enforcement notices. Similarly, to instigate to conduct proceedings in a magistrate's court means they can start even proceedings in a magistrate's court. Now the eighth question is, outline the purpose of employer's liability insurance. Very important question. So you can say, the purpose of employer's liability insurance is to satisfy a legal requirement for employers to carry such insurance so that an employee who is harmed due to the fault of his or employer is assured of receiving compensation that the employer might otherwise have insufficient resources to pay. In one word, you can say it is a legal requirement to make sure that employer paid to the worker in case of any accidents or in case of any emergencies. Similarly, this type of insurance is exerting significant pressure on employers to improve their standards of health and safety. They will be really forced to make sure that they improve the health and safety conditions in their company. Now our next question is, identify three key differences between civil law and criminal law. Very important question. So we'll be seeing the difference between the civil law and criminal law is the different objectives of two systems. In civil law, the objective is to get a financial claims, but in criminal law, the objective is to provide the punishment. Now, the another point is very important, friends. The burden of proof is required. So in a criminal court, a defendant, like the person who is guilty, he is either acquitted or found guilty beyond a reasonable doubt. But in a civil court, a plaintiff means the person who brings the case, who brings a lawsuit against a defendant. So in, for example, the plaintiff will be the employee and the law and the defendant will be the company. So in a civil court, the burden of proof will falls on the plaintiff, means it will falls on the guy who is bringing the case against the company, and he have to prove that the defendant, means the company, is responsible for the problem, for the settlements. So this is what the burden of proof. Similarly, the parties generally involved will be different, the two individuals rather than the state and an individual. For example, for the criminal laws, it will be between the state and the individual, but for the civil law, it will be the company and the people. Now the next question is, what are the general defenses available to an employer in a case of alleged negligence brought by an employee? So friends, these are the general defenses which are available to an employer in a case of alleged negligence which are brought by an employee. Like, there was no duty owed to the employee since the case which was referred something which did not take place during the course of employment. So this action or something, this incident happened which was not during the course of employment. Similarly, such a duty was owed, there was no breach in that, what happened was not foreseeable, and in the event everything reasonable had been done. Similarly, the loss, damage or injury was either non-existent or not caused by any breach, and that claimant voluntarily accepted the risk or the case was out of time. So it means in this case, the guy who worked there was, he himself voluntarily went for that work without considering the risk. So these are the defenses which an employer can make. Now we will be seeing the next question. Outline the three standard conditions that must be met for an employee to prove a case of negligence against an employer. So this is just the reverse of the question what we seen before. So the standard conditions for an employee to prove a case of alleged negligence against a employer is, firstly, that a duty of care was owed by the employer, that employer was responsible for that work. Similarly, secondly, that the employer acted in breach of that duty. The third, that breach led directly to the loss, damage or injury to the employee. Now our last question is, explain, give an example in each case, the circumstances under which a health and safety inspector may serve. The first one will be an improvement notice and a prohibition notice. So for the improvement notice, you can say, to serve an improvement notice, an inspector, health and safety inspector, must be of the opinion that there is a breach of relevant statutory provisions, or that there has been a breach that is likely to be continued or repeated. A relevant example would be a floor that has been poorly maintained in contravention of the requirements of the Workplace Health Safety and Welfare Regulations 1992. Now we'll be seeing the prohibition notice. For a prohibition notice to be served, an inspector must be of the opinion that there is or is likely to be a risk of serious personal injury. The relevant example, you can say, like a scaffolding which has been poorly constructed and is therefore in unsafe condition is there. So friends, stay tuned for more questions which we will be seeing in our next video. Don't forget to subscribe and share the channel with your other friends.